welcome to our Palm Sunday service. May the Lord bless you for joining us today. We will blend our voices to sing songs about Palm Sunday. And we're going to begin with hymn number 23. To God be the glory. Amen. Great things he has done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood. We're very happy to see everyone on this lovely Palm Sunday. The weather is so nice outside. It is the prayer of my heart that it will be so nice inside our hearts too. For our internet audience, wherever you are, we are here in London, where the weather is so lovely. Whatever your weather may be, wherever you are, we are praying that the Lord will bless you too there. And for those that are perhaps visiting locally and they would like to come in and join us, you have missed a beautiful collection of prelude. Not more than that, you can join us from here on to sing together and to enjoy the rest of the service. This is the Apostolic Faith, Fenham Road, number 95, Peckham Branch, SE151AE. If you are driving and you want to use your tom-tom, as they call it, you are very welcome to join us. And the Lord will bless you if you're able to do so. But if you're unable to do so, we still pray that the Lord will meet you wherever you are. Meanwhile, we continue with our service by singing hymn number 23 from Sacred Songs and Solos. We take verses 1 and 2 only. Verses 1 and 2 only, and 2 or 3 other songs from the same hymn book from Brother Delight, who is our song leader for this morning.
Continue to praise our God this morning from hymn 102. Hymn 102, Men of Sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came. Ruined sinners to reclaim, hallelujah, what a Savior. Mm-hmm. We're going to take the first verse, the third verse and the fourth verse while seated. The first, the third and fourth while seated.
Thank you.
is here to save this morning. We'll carry on singing from hymn 129. There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunged beneath that lose all their guilty stains. We're going to take the first and the fourth verse again while seated. Just the first and the fourth. Song before prayer will be 134. Near the cross, a trembling soul, love and mercy found me. There, the brighter morning star shared its beams around me. We're going to sing the first and the third verse while seated. Then, for those of us who can stand, we'll rise up to sing the fourth verse and remain standing to be led in prayer. We're going to request the orchestra to join us to sing the fourth verse while on our feet. The first, the third, while seated, and then we'll rise to sing the fourth verse.
Thank you.
While we remain standing with our eyes closed, Brother Godfrey will come forward to lead us in congregational prayer.
Oh Lord, our God, we praise your holy name. We worship you, Lord. We give you thanks.
Thank you,
for
Lord.
Your wondrous love towards us, guilty sinners. Thank you for the plan of redemption. For on this Palm Sunday, oh Lord, we just want you to help us by driving out all those things that will offend you from our lives.
Thank you, Lord.
Destroy all the handiworks of the devil.
Amen.
In every life standing here.
Oh yes, Father.
And help us, oh God, to appreciate what you did for us on Calvary. We're just coming to the cross. At Calvary, we bow. God, in humility, in full surrender, total yielding to you, that you will have your way in us, and make us your people indeed, as we look unto you to lead us to heaven at last. Lord, whatever you know will be good for us today, oh Lord. Do it for us, oh God.
Amen.
We want to leave this place today as your children indeed. In every way, in thought, in word, in action, in our relationships, oh Lord, that the life of Christ will be revealed in us. That from day to day, Lord, we will remain looking up for the rapture. Lord, help us, oh Lord.
Amen.
Wherever your people are gathered, even today, Lord,
Lord,
show forth your mighty power.
Amen.
Descend in a mighty way, oh God.
Amen.
Break the shackles of sin, oh God. Thank you, oh Lord.
Thank you,
we know you're going to send us a mighty revival.
Amen.
Lord, speak to us through your word.
Amen.
Lord, empower your servants, oh Lord,
Amen.
Giving us your word today.
Amen.
That everything that will be said and done would bring glory to you.
Yes.
And will be a blessing to us.
Amen.
Thank you. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh,
Our Bible reading is taken from the book of 1 Peter. 1 Peter chapter 2, we are reading from verse 21 to 25. 1 Peter chapter 2, reading from verse 21. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example, that ye should follow his steps. 22. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously. 24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Amen. The last verse, 25. For ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls. From the book of Lamentations, the first chapter. Lamentations, the first chapter, reading verse 12. Lamentations is the book that follows the one of Jeremiah. It's actually the Lamentations of Jeremiah. Chapter 1, reading verse 12. Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by? Behold and see, if there be any sorrow like unto my sorrow, which is done unto me, wherewith the Lord hath afflicted me in the day of his fierce anger. Is it nothing to you? In Christianity, the passion, when we talk about passion, or the passion of Christ in particular, refers to the suffering, the enduring. It's from the word, Latin word passionem, which is used to describe the short final period in the life of Jesus, starting from his triumphal entry into Jerusalem, leading to his crucifixion on Mount Calvary, and all defining the climactic event, which is central to Christian doctrine of salvation. And that is a wonderful thing, the passion of Christ. May that passion not be in vain. Amen. Over you and over me. Amen. The Passion Week, as we know it, starting from Palm Sunday today with triumphal entry to Jerusalem and the cleansing of the temple, which followed on Monday. We incidentally just returned from Israel, where we had the opportunity to visit all these sites where these actually happened. We were shown a place of where the cleansing of the temple took place, and what we have standing there right now is a mosque, just by the side of the Temple Mount. And the guide explained to us all that happened in that particular place where Jesus Christ cleansed the temple. On Tuesday, many things happened. Most significantly is the plot of the Jews and Judas started. On Wednesday, according to history, no record was really found exactly what happened, but it was believed that Jesus must have spent this day in retirement in Bethany. The agony in the garden and the betrayal happened on Thursday. And then on Friday, the judgment, the condemnation, the cross, and his death. Thank God it is a good Friday. Amen. For you and for me. Yes. Saturday is referred to as the Black Saturday. It was a day of wailing, a day of uncertainty, a day of what is going to happen next. Then comes the resurrection morning. And we leave that to resurrection day. We leave that to Easter Sunday. But perhaps today, as we have studied in our lesson, I want us to concentrate further on the passion of Christ as we are entering the Passion Week. I didn't plan for all this. Little did I even know that all the places that have been marked for us to visit will just coincide very well with the lessons that we are having recently. And that's the way I've been telling people while in Israel, that all these lessons we are learning, about three or four lessons for Easter, we can identify ourselves with those places where it actually happened. So it happened. It is real. Sure. You cannot doubt it. We were taken through the Palm Sunday route. And I remember as we were going through that route, we were just shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. No one was on the donkey. But we remember what happened. And we walked through that to the home of Caiaphas, where Jesus was judged. We were shown the dungeon where he was even kept for a while. And you need to see people trooping all over the world, just trying to see all these places. They are still there. It is true that they will build maybe a temple or a church on top of it, but underneath there, you still climb down to go and see all these places. And then we went through Via Della Rosa, where he carried his cross, then to Golgotha. They have all these places. And it is my prayer once more that the reality of the passion of Christ will not be in vain.
Amen.
Over my life and over your life.
Amen.
And in the life of our church and our family. Just as we have studied this morning, the suffering of Jesus was indescribable. I remember Sister Ayo in her contribution, which already I have in my own sermon notes, mentioned Mel Gibson's theme on the Passion of the Christ, which really you get to a place, even in that movie, you just cannot look. And just as she rightly said, that was even man depicting. And that was depicted very, very well. Until everything gushed out. Everything. The passion of Christ. May we not reject Jesus. So when the Bible says, Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by? The Bible is saying, in essence, that do you think it's a joke? Do you think it's something petty? Do you think it's something pointless and valueless? May we not lose the wonder of his passion.
Amen.
May we not lose the wonder of his love.
Amen.
The wonder of the cross and the cost that Jesus Christ paid so that you and I can have peace. What is it to you? I think I would like to return to the consideration of this suffering of Christ so that perhaps if we have anyone present here or those that are listening to me on the web, if this has not achieved anything in your life today, when we look into the scriptures together, you'll be able to pray for forgiveness.
Amen.
That you've been rejecting him for so long. And for those of us that have appreciated and have made use of that blood, may we appreciate it more today.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's turn to the book of Isaiah, that one chapter. Isaiah chapter 53 gave us a vivid description of all that happened. Verse 3 says, he is despised and rejected of men. Jesus Christ was despised and rejected. That is, he was hated. The Savior of the whole world was hated by those he came to save. He was not received joyfully. During our visit to the land of Israel, we were taken to the Mount of Precipice, where you can read in the Bible, in the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 4. You see there, after Jesus Christ has spoken to the people, they led him to a certain place with the main aim of killing him, with the main aim of just throwing him down the cliff. That they were playing with the Son of God. Jesus Christ got to the cliff, all right. Jesus Christ was standing at the cliff, all right. We went to that cliff. There's just no way of escape. when you are facing the crowd and the cliff, the vault is just down there and you are standing like that, all they meant to do was just to rush at him and push him down. Little effort. What does the Bible say? The Son of God. Amen. His time wasn't yet at that time. Yes. He just passed by. Amen. He just walked through them. They couldn't do anything to him. They hated him so much. You know, it's a pain to be rejected by someone that you love so much. We are looking at the passion of Christ. These are the same people that he came to redeem, the same people he came to save. And they did not hide the fact that we hate you. He had griefs and sorrows, still from that verse 3. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. He didn't blame anybody for his lot. He agreed to it. He bore it all. Yes, he was sorry for the pain of his people. One time he cried bitterly, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. How long, how often? I want to shield you. I want to keep you. And you will just not allow me to do so. Verse 4 says, surely he hath borne our grief and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Jesus Christ was stricken, smitten, and afflicted. Smitten with the tongue. All manners of evil that you can think of was said against him. Smitten with the hands. The hands that you can just do like this, and that hand can stay like that, and will not go down again at all. And he permitted those hands to be just banging on him like that. Verse 5 says, he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. When we look at his feet and his side, the crown of thorns, the blade whips. I think that was mentioned this morning. It wasn't just ordinary, just take belt out and be using on somebody. It's something that we cut the flesh, we rend the flesh. Verse 6 says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. What a load to carry. Just think of a time when you are under the burden of sin. Just your own sin. How heavy. How terrible. Now Jesus Christ carrying the sins of the whole world. He was oppressed. Verse 7. He was afflicted. He opened not his mouth. Brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before our shearers is dumb, he openeth not his mouth. He didn't plead his own innocency. He didn't do that. There was a time when people came to arrest him. And he spoke to them in the account of John, that who are you looking for? Just saying, who are you looking for? Just saying alone, just saying that alone. The Bible records they were just falling down. And now, he decided not to say anything. It's, you know, when you have power or authority or something given to you to use that you can use, and you refrain from using it. Jesus has the power to call down angels from above. Jesus has the power to make these people not to do anything to him. How many of us here, let's think about it. If you should know, if God will open your heart and eyes and mind to know the suffering that you are going to go through before you breathe your last, and even the time it is coming. Jesus knew all this. No wonder in that garden, and we were there too, you will feel the soberness, you will feel the serenity of heaven in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus Christ was trying to tell his father, "Dad, must I go through this? Because I know what is ahead of me. I know what these people are going to do." And he was praying the Father, "If there is any other way to redeem the whole world." And his Father in heaven has decided, "It has to be this way, son. You said you will go for them. You are there now for them." And then he was able to say, "Thy will now be done." Amen. Think about the love of Jesus for your soul, for my soul, so that you don't go to hellfire and I don't go to hellfire. In the passage that we read in 1 Peter chapter 2, it was mentioned there that who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. He was not suffering for his sins. He wasn't being judged for what he has done that was wrong. Verse 8 of our text in that Isaiah says that he was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. Not for his own sins. He was apprehended, made a prisoner, judged, accused, tried, condemned to die a cruel death in between two thieves. The agony of the cross, the ridicule, the pain, the test. Have you noticed that in the seven words on the cross, the first one was, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." May God help us to know what we are doing. Amen. For those who are still rejecting Christ, may God help you today to know what you are doing. Amen. The fourth saying was on Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? It was Martin Luther talking about this. He said, "This is the mystery of mysteries. God forsook God." Mystery of mysteries. Jesus is God.
Yes.
And now God forsaking God. What a mystery. You can imagine the kind of situation that the unsaved souls are. You can imagine the situation that anybody that is playing with salvation of his soul is in. It is terrible. But praise God, eventually, see part of the words on the cross, he said, "It is finished.
Amen.
I have come for that work, and by his power and grace, I have finished it."
Amen.
Satan, you are finished.
Yes.
Sickness, you are finished.
Yes.
Sorrow, you are finished.
Amen.
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 And yet, we still have people today still not claiming that. that it is finished. Still suffering, languishing under the hand of the enemy that the Lord has come to deliver them from, to deliver all of us from. Is it nothing to you? Actually, if you look at this thing, I heard all the contributions this morning, fantastic, wonderful. But can we turn the table around to ourselves? Are we not also humiliating Jesus today? It's very easy to talk about the Jews. Very easy to even exclaim at all that Jesus went through. How about you? How about me? Look into your life. Many people are still holding hammer in their hand. Not physically, still driving in that nail, knocking it on Jesus. Yet unsaved, that is what you are doing. That blood doesn't make any sense to you. Is it nothing to you? This is something great. This is something wonderful. Salvation is free for you and for me. But it is important for us to know that the fact that it is free for you and for me, that doesn't mean that it has no price. The price was paid. Fully paid. Completely paid. And God in heaven was satisfied. That is why on that glorious day, when I knelt down to call upon Jesus, when I knelt down to call upon God and confess my sins and plead for the blood of Jesus, God answered my prayer.
Amen.
And is he doing that today?
Yes.
And is he want to do it for you today?
Yes.
I had a teacher this morning talking about sicknesses and illnesses and things like that. Hallelujah!
Amen.
We can be healed today.
Amen.
Not because of any good thing we have done.
Never.
When we pray, God will remember.
Amen.
What my son went through.
Amen.
Is for this prayer of healing.
Oh, yeah.
That this my son, this my daughter, this my people are praying about. God will answer.
Amen.
As he has always been answering, he will continue to answer.
Amen.
Well, when the Bible says, is it nothing to you? You know, for the majority of the Jews, it is nothing to them. Unfortunately, the guide that took us around, they like to take you to the Holocaust Museum, where they love to talk a lot about the suffering, where you see a lot the display of all that truly happened. He was telling us with tears before we entered the museum. He gave even his own family tree history of all that they suffered and everything. And when he was talking to us before we entered that museum, he said, "Where was God?" And he was saying, "Where was the president of the United States?" We got in touch. They got in touch when the train would be carrying the Jews to the gas chamber, and they were saying, "The president of the United States said, we have more priority than that now." But again, where I was standing there and I was listening to him. This is someone that is not a believer, a Jew. And I was saying in my heart, that you are only looking at one side of this story. There is another side to it. There is another side to it. This is what God himself has said will happen, as difficult to believe as it is in terms of the suffering, inasmuch as it is nothing to you, the death of Jesus Christ. They are still expecting their Messiah, he told us. And they are ready. I think this teller that confronted him one time like that. And they are ready in terms of how about this second coming? Where they said they will now face him and then they will check And if it is now true that he was the one that came, now they will now say, okay, we are right all together. I pray it will not be too late then. They have forgotten the time that they are saying the blood, his blood, be on us and on our children. And truly they suffered. They suffered. It's all over the world. It's everywhere. But let's leave a nation because God is still looking after them. Let's come back to ourselves. Many of us are suffering today. Because we are just trampled under our feet, the blood of our Redeemer. Well, many of us are just worshiping him with our mouth. We worship him with our long dresses and dressing fine and everything. But the heart is polluted. The heart is far, far, far away from him. Did God not say in his word that the time will come for you rejecting me, you will boil your own children, you will kill and cook them and eat them? Didn't that happen? Yeah. To reject Jesus Christ with all that he has gone through is a terrible thing. May you not reject him.
Yeah.
May God help you to think today. This thing that we are saying, this thing that the word of God is telling us, he didn't do anything. He never did anything in the least to deserve all this. He endured the contradiction of sinners against himself. And verse 10 of that Isaiah 53 says, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. Pleased the Lord to bruise him? In order for him to die, to make atonement for all of us, he became obedient, submitted to the death of the cross. The significance of all this, I return to verse 6. All we like sheep have gone astray. You see what will not just make Jesus Christ to back off? They have all gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And there is no way. We don't know the way back home again. And unless he died for us, we will die in our sins. Because we cannot find our way back to God. Thank God for Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In that 1 Peter, the text that we read together, if you quickly return there, 1 Peter chapter 2, says that, verse 24, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed, for ye were as sheep going astray. That is true. But are now, hallelujah.
Amen.
That is only possible because of the suffering of Jesus Christ. But are now returned. Have you returned? Returned unto the shepherd and bishop, our overseer. Bishop of our souls. When the Bible says that he has laid on him the iniquities of us all, he's trying to say that he's taken from us. What is laid on others, taken from one place to the other, is no more there. It's a shame if some people are still carrying their sins with them today. When God is saying, the death of Jesus Christ is to take your sins, I have someone to lay it upon. Someone who is ready to bear it. May you release them.
Amen.
Verse 5, another significance. He was wounded for our transgressions. Have you sinned against God? Any transgressions in your life? Jesus Christ is wounded for that purpose. He was bruised for our iniquities. If you want peace, the chastisement, the source of your peace is the chastisement of Jesus Christ. Amen. And the stripes that he received as a result of that, hallelujah, we are healed.
Amen.
That is wonderful. That is just great. Finally, ultimately, the death of Jesus Christ says in 1 Peter 3:18, "For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust." For what purpose? That he might bring us to God.
Amen.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
The death of Jesus will bring us to God here on earth.
Yes.
Enjoy relationship with God here on earth.
Amen.
And at last, in Jesus' name,
amen,
take us to heaven.
Amen.
To be with Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The death of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The passion of Christ. Will you let that be in vain? Is it not something that you want to think about? Is it now something to you? Or will you be like some people that it is nothing to them? The death of Jesus, when he said, "It is finished," and he gave up the ghost, and he died for you and for me. It is the prayer of my heart that today it will mean something for your life.
Yeah.
Today it will achieve something in your life.
Yeah.
I'm asking those who would like to call upon him to come forward to the altar and come and pray and speak to him as we sing, "Christ, our Redeemer, died on the cross." You are invited to come forward to pray. God bless you.
Shed on Calvary.
Amen.
Lord, let your blood flow today.
Amen.
Let it flow through these altars.
Amen.
And through the benches.
Amen.
And flow in every heart of each of us, Lord.
Amen.
Save.
Amen.
Sanctify.
Amen.
Baptize with the Holy Ghost and fire.
Amen.
Heal the sick.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you.
Thank you. Oh.
You died for us.
Oh, yes.
Thank you for your blood.
Yes.
It is too powerful.
Yeah.
It can save today.
Yes.
Lord, help us to believe.
Amen.
And touch Amen. Your cross.
Amen.
Today, it's our salvation.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.